Andrew, let's move on straight to the topics and let's talk about your story. Kevin Burkhart taking over number one play-by-play announcer for Fox Sports. I have a couple of questions. Based off your reporting and stuff that I've heard as well, it was kind of expected that Burkhart was going to step up into that chair. What's going on with the analyst beat?
Greg Olson is the guy to beat in that spot, right? So if you're Fox, you're looking at it like you have Greg Olson, he's your number two. We know he's there and we can figure out, do we need to, you know, rip up his contract, change that up? He's not getting that Aikman, et cetera, money, Romo money. He's only in his second year. If I were him, I would take a deal. I take what they offered and do really well two of the next three Super Bowls, and the money is going to be there in the future. And especially with the other things he wants to do in the podcast world, it's what a platform he would have. So I just think you want to get that job. I wouldn't personally, you want to get paid somewhat what you deserve. But remember when Romo came in, he made $3 million to $3 to $4 million a year for his first contract. So to me, that's sort of the range now where you're Greg Olson, maybe you might shoot for. I think he's at about $1.7 million from Fox. Maybe a little bit of a raise, but you want to get that job. That said, I think that they're looking around a little bit. They don't feel like there's nobody else. Everyone else, all the chairs are filled in terms of the number one analyst. So someone, if you want a wild card, Phil Rivers is someone who has repeatedly shown he doesn't want to do it. But I do think Fox would like to hear what he sounds like. He's a guy, Sean Payton. There's been reports of him doing it. I don't see that. I think they look at him more as a studio guy, maybe in that number two spot. I don't see how you could go Sean Payton over Greg Olson, and even Phil Rivers over Greg Olson. I'm not sure you could do that. When you put a rookie in there, as good as Kevin Burkhart is at setting up his analyst, you're taking a chance in the Super Bowl year.
Fox has always viewed itself as having the deepest bench. You took their number one team, which is Buck and Aikman, put them over at ESPN. You promoted their number two team, Burkhart and Greg Olson. They're now going to be the number one team most likely.
I just want to interrupt you there just because Burkhart, we were talking last week, kind of knew it's going to be Burkhart. I think it probably will be Greg Olson, but I don't think that's a definite. I think there's other people. The other one people talk about is John Lynch. I don't think that's happening. The 49ers GM worked with Burkhart previously. Those two are tight as well, but he said no to Amazon right away after one dinner when they came after him. I'm talking about Lynch. I just don't see it. I think he's committed. It's the middle of free agency and he's that type of guy. Although this two Super Bowls in the next 3 years, possibly doing this for the next 20 years could be something that you would think could interest Lynch, but I think he's committed to the 49ers.
Said no after one dinner. Where was that dinner?
I think the dinner was at his house, actually.
Oh, okay. I thought he invited them over. Great.
All right, on the spot, asking me where the dinner was. I didn't know where the dinner was. I think it was at Lynch's house.
It could have been like at a McDonald's, and it would have been like, I'm out, guys. Who is poised to step in to be the number two team at Fox?
So there are some choices. I would say Adam Amin is in there. Joe Davis is in there. Joe Davis is likely another one pretty much expected. He's going to be replacing Joe Buck on the World Series, working with John Smoltz. So Joe Davis is someone who can move into that number two slot. Gus Johnson, wild card, who's number one college football play-by-player. Could they move him to the NFL? I don't think so. I think they'll keep him on college and just do some NFL like they did in previous years. But if I were to guess, I probably right now would go Adam Amin getting that number two slot. Maybe Davis. I think if you look at what Fox is doing, Brad Zager, their executive producer, has added these guys the last couple of years. If you look at the turnover at Fox over the last few years in the announcer, play-by-players, especially, and analysts on NFL, they've changed things. And I think if you look at what the situation that some of these networks have gotten into, where they're just kind of have everyone do all the big events, and Fox had that with Joe Buck. He was doing the Super Bowl. He was doing the World Series. When they had golf, he was their main golf guys. Nance at CBS, same thing with Jim Nance. They have Nance doing the top games or the NCAA tournament, even though he doesn't do the basketball all year. He's with Romo on the NFL. And then, of course, where he's best at is golf and the Masters, et cetera. If you're a network, it used to be you spread it out a little bit. And I just think where cost is, that probably might make your cost a little bit easier. You can defer it a little bit, even though you're paying three people. In theory, when they're doing, if you have two, three different people, maybe you don't have to pay them as much each to do that. And I just think it protects yourself a little bit more. You don't get in that situation where you have one person. So to answer your question, that's why I probably think Amin could be Davis. I think Davis might be better in football than he is on baseball, but I like Adam Amin a lot too. So I didn't answer it fully because I don't know. I don't think they know. So that's one of those things.
But you gave the names, but you didn't mention any analysts. Who's sitting there possibly to slip into the number two chair as the analyst?
Yeah, let me also mention Kevin Kugler, who they like. I don't think he'll get it, but I think he's worth mentioning. You know, they also have Kenny Albert, who's been at that number two slot. I don't think he'll get it, but you know, he's doing fine with the Stanley Cup. So they're deep. Then on the analyst side, look, someone they like a lot is Mark Sanchez. I'm not saying he's going to get it, but if you were to ask me, someone who's kind of on the way up in their eyes, Sanchez is someone. I think John Vilma is someone they would consider as well. He worked with Kenny Albert. I think Sanchez is someone I think to watch internally. Now, could they go externally? Could they try a Sean Payton? The problem with Payton is he's kind of shown an inclination that he wants to coach. So you're going to spend all this time, pass over other people, and he's going to go coach the Cowboys in a year. So I think that hurts Payton a little bit, even though now he's kind of backtracked and that's like, no, maybe I'll be in TV forever. And maybe he will. But I think he's more of a studio guy.
The headline to me, Andrew, is that free agent frenzy has been downgraded. It's no longer a frenzy, but there's still some movement and these stories aren't going to end.
What is it then? You got to give me an alliteration. It's a fracas, a free agent. What we got?
Oh, fracas. I like that one. That's good.
Free agent finale. It never is over though. It hasn't percolated for a long time. In terms of this type of movement. And he had the Romo contract, but he just stayed at CBS. And that was kind of a frenzy because ESPN was going after him, but he ended up staying at CBS. I don't know if these jobs will, you know, they might change over a little bit more than they have in the past. You know, those older guys have kind of held on to those jobs forever. And a lot of them are great. You know, Al Michaels is great. You know, obviously it loosens it up a little bit. And I think, you know, networks, they have to look at what they're doing and figuring things out as we go forward, especially with their paying these guys. You've got to be worth it. You got to be doing a good job. Like you start making 15, 18, 12 and a half million dollars. All these guys, Collinsworth, Aikman, Romo, you better produce, you better do a good job.
You know, one of the complaints I consistently hear from TV executives is that it's so hard to develop young talent because there's no young talent. I consider Kevin Burkhardt sort of like a young play-by-play guy, and he's in his late 40s now.
He's 48.
Yeah, exactly. It's young to me.
These guys will hung on forever. I mean, again, Al Michaels is great, but he's 77. You know, this contract will take him to what, 80? And so with Amazon, you know, this is a great job. I mean, Jim Nantz. You know, these days age is different, but he's in his going to be, I think, 63 this year. Someone like Ian Eagles in his 50s, you know, he's not a young, I mean, it's not old necessarily, you know, as all of us get older, we're all like, oh, that's not old.
Sounds young now.
Yeah, exactly. When I was 22, I don't know if I'd say 50 somethings, you know, I would say that, you know, but the people healthier, living longer, you only work 5 months a year. So Kirk Herbstreit is going to have a busy schedule, but okay. Come, January the 20th, he's done, right? There's no more college football. There's no more NFL for him. And then you don't start up for real until August. So it's a pretty good gig.
Who's going to pitch us that story about how busy he's working? Is it going to be ESPN PR or Amazon PR? Which one? Prediction.
I don't know. Yeah, I'm not writing that. That's
all right. Let's go.
He will be working hard. That will be a lot. That's going to be interesting to watch because it is a lot to know and doing these games a little harder than people think. But cry me a river, you know, flying private jets and, you know, he's making a lot of money. And again, it's half a year. So, but he will be working hard.